SRI. Oh, and we're gonna record today to so that we can post this on the website for anyone who wasn't able to attend. I'm gonna turn my camera off because I think my internet is a little crazy, but I'll keep talking. And I think we're gonna start out with some polls so that we can get to know who's here and what your experience is and what your role is when it comes to PPEP. So Greta, if you wanna go ahead and start those polls. So our first question is, what is your role in your state's PPEP? The second question is around the status of your state's PPEP, all the way from what's a PPEP to we're implementing and ready to go. Third question is, if you're in the process of making revisions, what are you working on? And the fourth question is, what is your biggest challenge? All right, I see some answers coming in. All the questions, you kind of have to scroll a little to get to all the questions to answer them. All right, looks like we've got a lot of folks who are responsible for managing or conducting some part of the evaluation. That's a great group to have here with us. That makes perfect sense. Some grant managers, some contractors. I don't see anyone who says what's a PPEP, so that's even better. Everyone looks like a pretty good spread in terms of where folks are at with implementing their PPEP. Looks like at least some folks are making progress and changes and revisions and all of the different areas. Although I think maybe you can't see the poll results.
Now we can, thank you.
Can you see the poll results now?
Yes, now we can.
Okay, thanks, Richard. So, like I said,
someone will have to scroll up from 1 to 2 to 3, etc.
Okay. Does it work when I do it?
If you're doing it now, it's not happening.
Okay.
So you can do it yourself. You can scroll yourself.
Oh, okay. You can scroll yourself. So where was I? I was down here at the bottom. Let's see. Biggest challenges. Looks like the biggest challenge was alignment of PPEP with the strategic plan. That's really good to know. We're going to talk about that today. There's actually a poll question a little bit later around the strategic plan. So I think this information is great. I think it gives us a sense of who's with us today, helps Kathy and Judy know the crowd they're presenting to, and I think you all are in the right place. So thanks. If I click stop sharing, then I think it goes away, right? And now I'm gonna go ahead and pass things over to Judy to talk about how we got here and where we're headed.
Thanks, Mandy. Yes, so I know that we have some new folks who are joining us today who haven't been here since the beginning of the grant period, almost 3 years ago. So I thought it'd be great to kind of just walk down memory lane and remind ourselves of what we were supposed to do and what we're trying to do, and hopefully how we can look at opportunities for perpetuating the program performance evaluation plan going forward beyond the grant period. So just as a reminder, so how did we get here and where are we going? So we can all agree that this last year has been, that a lot has happened over the past 3 years. You received an initial grant, which one of your four deliverables required the development of a program performance evaluation plan. The intent of the PPEP was to evaluate the implementation of the grant, but also to establish a means for continuing to measure progress of your early childhood efforts within your state. There were key elements of the plan you were to address, including creating a logic model, identifying metrics and data measures, analyzing and reporting and sharing the information with key stakeholders, and including parents as part of that process for input. And your plan was to align with your needs assessment and the goals within your strategic plan. You were to submit that plan by the end of the initial grant period to your federal project officer. And although we didn't review and approve the PPEPs, they were noted as received in meeting a required deliverable for your grant. When you applied for and were awarded your renewal grant, PPEP was added to Activity 6, which some of you may recall, which required you to continue to refine and enhance and implement the PPEP with the most recent needs assessment, which is also in alignment with another requirement of your renewal grant. Hopefully this isn't a reminder and you know this already, that you need to update your needs assessment at least once during the 3 years of your renewal grant. So some of you have already been in the process of that. Some of you will be looking at updating your needs assessment within this coming year. And you were also to commit to allocating at least 5 to 7% of your federal award towards the updating enhancement of your PPEP, which many of you did that when you just submitted your non-compete continuation application. So today, what we're trying to say is you've submitted your PPEP once. You're not going to have to resubmit a PPEP for review or indicate or for us to indicate that it was received. You submitted your plan, you're going into your third year of implementation. You want to make sure you're continuing to enhance the plan for your response for purposes beyond the grant period. This may call for some transition, moving from measuring short-term activities listed in your grant to building a sustainable system of ongoing evaluation for your early childhood mixed delivery system beyond the grant period. We also recognize that as well as you have, that this has been unprecedented time and the impact on many of your activities and efforts have been thwarted by COVID. When the requirements for the grant were drafted, it was designed for times of normalcy, and many of you are concerned and challenged with measuring the progress of your activities and towards achieving your goals outlined in your strategic plan. But what many of you have discovered during this unprecedented time is that you have revealed other areas of need that you may not have discovered if this had been a time of normal early childhood implementation. As I mentioned before, one of the requirements of your renewal grant is to update your needs assessment. And many of you, like I said, have been taking the opportunity over the past year to update your needs assessment and have discovered these newly identified areas that were not considered before. In addition, many of you are taking the president's executive orders in charge for the country to address areas of inequality and equity and adding it to your needs assessment and your efforts to measuring progress. So let's think about sustainability beyond the grant period, which will include activities to support coming out of the pandemic period. We want to emphasize today that the PPEP is a living document. It is a document designed for you, customized for you to meet the needs within your state. As you go into your third year, I know you know that modifications need to be made, and coming out of the pandemic may call for some short-term activities or short-term goals and efforts, but also in the long-term, as you continue to build a means for continuous quality improvement for your state next delivery system going forward. So think about sustainability. How can you continue to build this process into your ongoing activities beyond the grant period? Hopefully today, Kathy will provide you with some solutions to some of the challenges that you're facing in the coming year as you continue to build your sustainable PPEP and a system of continuous quality improvement. So I am going to turn this back over to Mandy, who I believe is going to go ahead and introduce Kathy, who is going to provide you with some solutions to some of your challenges. Thanks.
Thanks, Judy. Yeah, that was a great way to get us started. I'm going to go ahead and leave my camera off just in case something crazy is happening with my internet. So thanks for understanding technical difficulties. And next up, I'm going to pass it over to Kathy Hubler. She's with the PDG B-5 TA Center at SRI, and she's going to go over some of the common challenges we've been seeing as we've reviewed PPEPs and talked with folks about developing theirs and some solutions. I also forgot to mention at the beginning that this webinar is scheduled for 90 minutes, and we may not have that much content, so there'll be lots of time to ask questions at the end. So if you want to type questions into the chat or pause Kathy as she's going, we'll have lots of time at the end, so keep the questions coming in. And I'll go ahead and pass it over to Kathy.
Thanks, Mandy. Hi, everyone. It's really nice to be with you today. As Mandy said, I'm Kathy Hebler with the PDG B5 TA Center. And we're going to dive into the PPEP today. Okay, next slide. Hopefully nobody needs this slide, but just to make sure we're all on the same page, the PPEP, as you heard Judy say, is a plan. And the critical word there is the one that's in that coral color, living, that you at this point have probably all finished at least one version, maybe a second version, but it is living and it's supposed to be changing. So that's absolutely appropriate. So some of those questions to ask yourself are the bullets down there. Does your PPEP reflect what you are doing right now, your current set of activities? Once upon a time, you had a logic model. Does that logic still make sense? Have you learned more in some of your implementation activities that would suggest maybe you need to rethink the logic of some of those? Even if it did make sense back when you put it together, 2020 came and changed everything. And so does it still make sense now? Way back when you put in what kind of data you were going to collect. Is that still useful to you? Is it still feasible? So those are the kinds of questions that you should be asking yourself as you take another look at your plan. Next slide. And by the way, as Mandy mentioned, I would love for this to actually be a little bit of a dialogue. And so Mandy, or I'm going to assume you can see the chat. If anybody wants to chat a question along the way, come off mute and ask a question. As Mandy mentioned, we have plenty of time to talk today. So I don't need to just keep talking. I would love for people to ask questions along the way. I want to point out a resource to you. If you haven't seen this, it is available on the PDG B5 website. The links are right there for two things. One is this little brief, which is a summary of some key issues with PPEP. And the other is an overview webinar that we did about a year or so ago. One of the big differences for us as TA providers between where we were when we did that webinar and where we are now is we've had the chance in between to look at a lot of PPEPs. So that gives us a much better grounding to know kind of what states are struggling with. And that's some of the things I'm going to be talking about today. And that's also some of the things that are summarized in that brief. So if you haven't seen it, I would certainly encourage you to take a look at it. Next slide. Okay, just real basic components, things that you should have in your PPEP. Putting the link in the chat, that would be a very good idea, Mandy, or if you could do that or someone could do that, I think that would be great. Components, logic model.
Kathy, do you want to know chat comments as they come in, or do you want to wait and collect them as we go along?
I think they're relevant to, I mean, if it's a general comment, then
okay,
I think
I'm gonna read this one.
Okay,
something we hear from our PPEP partners is that the project is not long enough to report on outcomes. However, our logic model clearly indicates outcomes. Wondering if we revise the language on the logic model, but not sure what this might look like.
Okay, I'm gonna give an answer to that, but Richard, Judy, I also wanna make sure that I'm not overstepping my bounds. So if I say anything, please jump in. As it says actually on that bullet, see the word short, intermediate, and long-term. Many of the long-term outcomes are long-term changes for children and families that are not going to happen in the time of your PPE, of your PDG B-5 funding. But what your logic model should be laying out is what's happening along the way. And the whole point of a logic model is to say, if we do A, then B is going to happen. If B happens, then C is going to happen. If C happens, then we get to our long-term outcomes. Okay, but those are 7, 8, 5 years down the road. Yes, you're not going to be able to get that data during the time frame, but what you should be able to get data on are the A's and the B's, the short term. And if your A doesn't happen, your whole point of your logic model is your B's not gonna happen. If you don't implement such and such well, then you're not gonna get those short term outcomes that you're predicting, like good family participation. If you don't get good family participation, you're certainly not gonna get family change. So the whole point of the logic model is also to be clear on your timeframe. But what you can measure, you should also be explicit on what you can measure during that time frame. If at the end of the time frame, you've gotten what you predicted with regard to short or intermediate, you're on your way to your long-term outcomes, and that's the best you can do. Is that helpful? And Richard or Judy, is there anything you want to add?
No, I think you really covered it, Richard.
No, I was going to say that's fine for now. I think what we'll do is we'll go back after the whole presentation is over. And if people still need clarity, please take notes on that so you can come back to an issue if you don't feel it was fully addressed. But we want to balance both Kathy's movement through her slides, but also addressing questions as they come up.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, sounds good. Okay, so just again, review of the components. And we're gonna talk about these things as we go through. You've got your logic model, you've got questions, you've got indicators and measures, you've got data sources and data collection methods, and you've got some kind of a plan for analysis and reporting. We're gonna cover each of those. Okay, next slide.
All right, and here comes our next poll. I promised we would talk again about the strategic plan. So here's a question to help Kathy tailor her remarks. How would you describe the status of your state's comprehensive early childhood strategic plan referenced in your PDG B-5 initiative? There's a few choices. Pick the one that's best. You can always chat if you have more to say. Looks like so far most of the responses, there's a heavy majority towards that the state has one comprehensive early childhood plan implemented and shared across services. A few states have a strategic plan solely for use in the PDG grant. And then a few states have multiple. I think, Greta, do you want to go ahead and share the results? So that's where we got around half the participation. Meredith put a comment in the chat that it's unclear about the relationship between the strategic plan, PPEP, and the PPR, new or old, all our acronyms. So Meredith, we'll keep your question, and then maybe Kathy, as she talks, will address some of those things. Kathy, are you good with anything else to say about those results? Or Richard?
I think the most important thing I would say is that although the PPEP was created as part of the PDG B-5 grant process and requirements, as Judy's already said, this is intended to really reflect your entire early childhood care and education system and the work that's done. So even when PDG ends, you will still have a PPEP that you're using within your state that helps you think about outcomes and processes and evaluative pieces that you need to be thinking about. So don't think about this tool as something that's specific to PDG only. It's intended to inform the entire system in your state.
Okay. I think Kathy will just keep.
Yeah, next week. I think that was really helpful. I think that's good to know. And why did we ask that? Because we're going to talk about the relationship between the PPEP and the strategic plan. One of the things we learned right away in our review is that a number of states, for some reason, were aligning their evaluation plan with the proposal categories rather than with the state strategic plan. If you are one of those states, the goal here is that your PPEP align with your strategic plan activities. Now, if you haven't done that, the solution is redo it and realign. Align is going to be our word of the hour. I'm going to talk a lot about align, align, align. So first and foremost, your PPEP has to be aligned with your strategic plan. Now, your strategic plan may be huge. I mean, that comprehensive word can cover a lot of territory. We're going to talk about prioritizing. You cannot evaluate everything. You shouldn't try to evaluate everything if you've got a really big plan. You're going to have to figure out key components. What is it that you're doing with PDG B-5? For PDG B-5, PPEP, focus on those things. But you may even have to select among those things because some of the states are doing a very large number of things. So prioritize. You don't have to hit every note in the music at exactly the same intensity. You can hit some things lightly. You can hit some things more deeply. You have to prioritize. I think the other thing is I want to circle back to what Judy said about the needs assessment. If you're redoing your needs assessment, presumably you're learning new things. If you're learning new things, that might have implications for your plan. If your plan changes, then your PPEP has to change as well to keep them aligned. So align, align, align is our message here. Okay, next slide. Logic models. I noticed on the poll that there weren't too many folks who said that logic models are a challenge. And we're never quite sure how to interpret that, whether that means everybody's really got it or everybody doesn't care enough about them to want to know more. Whether for some people it's just a step. From an evaluation standpoint, it is absolutely critical to a good PPEP. You cannot invest enough in your logic model, because if your logic model is good, it will then drive everything else you are doing. It will drive your evaluation questions. It will drive your data collection. So it is really important. One of the things we saw in our reviews is some variation on logic models. There were some that were so complex, it was very difficult to navigate them. And we would imagine they don't communicate very well to your stakeholders either as a tool if they've got too much in them. Others were really too simple, and so simple that the logic between the activities, the outputs, and the outcomes wasn't really obvious, because what folks had done, and some of this was the one page thing of trying to get everything onto one page. So you had a long list of activities, you have a long list of outputs, you have a long list of outcomes, but none of the connections are obvious. And the whole point of a logic model is, what's the logic? How does A get to B? And is and if you just put a whole bunch of A's in one column and a whole bunch of B's in another column, you've lost the connection. Now, some of that, again, goes back to this multiple project notion of states are doing multiple things, and we know that. One solution is, if you're doing multiple things, then create individual logic models for your different projects, because you're doing very different kinds of things. And what you get with, say, a coordinated enrollment activity is going to be very different than what you get with improving quality of childcare activities. So make those logic models separate. And then for communication purposes, you can create what we call a super logic model that does kind of take the 10,000 foot view, but make sure that you've got the individual logic models laid out so that you really can check along the way whether the things that you are predicting to happen did happen. Because if they didn't, that's your message to change right there. There's no sense continuing to collect data along the chain. If the first thing predicted to happen didn't happen, change, redo, see if you can make it happen, and then continue on with the change. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Oh, back there, yeah. Evaluation questions. Again, what we saw in our reviews is we saw the gamut of PPEPs that had no evaluation questions and PPEPs that had 200 evaluation questions. In either direction, it's very hard for those questions to be useful. So what we are recommending is that for general communication purposes, write your key questions about your activities at a meaningful level for most stakeholders. For example, was X implemented? Was developmental screening implemented? Was the transition project implemented? How well was the transition project implemented? Did transition project produce the intended outcomes? Now, those who are actually carrying out the work, and I noticed some of you are the evaluators, some of you are overseeing the evaluation, you'll want probably a more detailed set of questions that are the sub-bullets under, well, what do we mean by how well was it implemented? It means, did this happen? Did this happen? Did that happen? But for general communication purposes, we're recommending you stay at the general level of the kind of, it's not 10,000 feet, it's more like 100 feet, but a little bit above all the detail. But you need a set of questions to drive your work, because it also makes your reporting so much easier. When you go to write it up, what you're reporting is the answers to your questions. It gives you your organizer for your report in a really nice way. Okay. Let's go on to the next slide. All right, inputs, activities, outputs, and outcomes. These are all, as you're probably recognizing, categories off of a logic model, and also all things that need to be measured. some of the challenges that we saw were not providing very clear definitions or descriptions of what these things are. And again, this issue of coming in at the right level of specificity, not so general that it doesn't say anything, but not so specific that you get way too much detail for anybody to follow. And I'm going to go to the solution, and then I'm going to show you the example at the bottom. So the solution, not surprisingly, is enough detail, enough detail, but not so much detail. So look at that example down there. So if you have an activity that is described as facilitate coordination between school system and local community-based programs, that's probably a little too general for an evaluation because you don't really get a sense of what's being done. So what does it mean to facilitate coordination? So get a little more specific than that. It could be, for example, what the state is actually doing with the PDG B-5 funds is provide grants to local communities to establish community councils. Well, that's at a level where you can definitely say, how well did we implement this? Where the first one is a little too vague. Where you don't want to go is that next level, which are actually the task. Write text for community applications, announce application process, review applications submitted. That's a monitoring task, it's a management task. The evaluation doesn't need to work at that fine grain of a level. So stay enough at the descriptive level so you can describe what you're doing, but you don't have to task break it into tiny little pieces. That's too much information. Okay, next slide. Okay, let's talk about indicators and measures. This is a really important area, particularly around outcomes measurement, and can be very challenging, largely because it's off. We have lovely, lovely goals, long-term outcomes that we want for children and families. We want children to be healthy. We want children to experience good transitions. We want children to be ready for school. But those things don't suggest the measurement automatically. You have to come up with, and what does that mean for children to be ready for school? How do we talk about that? What is it that we need to measure so that we know children are ready for school? That's the indicator piece of it. The outcome is, example down there, children will experience good transitions from preschool to kindergarten. That does not say how to measure it. So let's get a little more precise. That's the indicator. 90% of parents will report, presumably that's a survey, that their child experienced a good transition by September of 2022. Note that in that indicator, it begins with a number or a percent. So what's your criteria? How will you know when you're successful? Specify the intended beneficiaries, in this case, it's the child. Specify the amount of change, how much. Now it just says a good transition, and that's probably that is the criteria that would be probably some variation on a survey question, and specify by when. So, and you can also set this up so that you're tiering it. So you can have 75% of parents by 2022 and 90% of parents by 2023 kind of thing. But you need a criteria for success, and that's what your indicator is. It makes your outcomes measurable. Some of the things we saw were indicators that weren't developed, or they weren't well aligned to the outcomes, or they didn't contain all of the elements above. The alignment issue was huge. So if you have an outcome that says children will experience good transitions, and then what you're measuring is percent of developmental screenings, you've got something, but you don't have a match between your indicator and your outcome. So it's really important that those two be aligned. If you look at your set of indicators and see any of the things that I've been talking about here, consider please developing them, either revising them to be better indicators or developing indicators that in fact reflect your measurement. Okay, let's go on. Data sources. This is a huge one, and it was interesting, I think, in the poll, the data analysis and reporting and the data collection issues were a big one for folks right now. And hopefully you are collecting data because you are well in to your PDG B-5 work. Basically, it boils down to you have two sources of data you can use, and it's either data you're already collecting or it's new data. Data you're collecting, we call administrative data. We know childcare collects data, education collects data, special ed collects data. There's a lot of data that is being collected in states already. If you are working toward getting an early childhood integrated data system, that adds power and value to your administrative data. By putting those data sets together, you can answer just so many more questions at such a different level. So there's a lot to be gained with an ECIDS, but even if you don't have an ECIDS yet or a functioning one yet, you can still look at the administrative data you have for how it can be used for some of these indicators and some of these long-term outcomes. The new data. Now, the new data are things like surveys, like focus groups, like interviews. They tend to be one time or time limited. I mean, very few states have things. Now, so there are some things that are set up like a family survey that goes out every year. You've got your mechanisms all set up. So some of that is not new data. It's actually data. I would put that more in the administrative data category because it's data you're already collecting. Again, make use of it. But if you look at your strategic plan, you look at your PPEP and you say, you know, there's just nothing we are collecting right now. And some of your implementation data about the how well did we implement is probably in this category that is going to need to be new data. Challenges that we saw in looking at some of the PPEPs. There were quite a few where the data source was not identified. So it was difficult to tell how the state was collecting. We've got our alignment issue again. Data was being collected, but it wasn't well aligned with either the evaluation question it was supposed to answer or with the outcome that was being measured. The other challenge, and this is one where we really need to talk about balance and priority, is the is states that were proposing an enormous number of data collections that were very resource intensive. Now you've got funding in your PDG B-5 grant to do this, but we also want to think about how to use your funding judiciously to think in the direction of sustainability. The one-time data collections, you know, you go around the state and you do 500 focus groups. You might get a great deal of information, but it's not sustainable. You're not going to be able to do that every year. So what kind of data collection can you do? What kind of things can you put in place that allows you to continue to have information for program improvement? I think one of the big messages here is this evaluation is not meant to just be PDG B5. It's meant to be ongoing information for your system to do ongoing improvements. But to do that, the mechanisms have to be sustainable. You can't do one-time data collections and then work off that data for the next 10 years. So think sustainability, think long-term, think what will allow our state to have information in 3 years, 5 years, 7 years that will allow us to continue to improve our programs and services for children and families. And that's kind of why we circle back to the administrative data and the ECIDS then, because that kind of an investment allows you to continue to have data into the future. So if you are still making choices about data, think sustainable, think long-term, think what allows our state to continue to make, to have good information, to make decisions going forward. So solutions, first of all, identify your data sources for all your evaluation questions, all your indicators. Again, you can prioritize your evaluation questions. If you have 10 questions, you may choose that six of them to be really important to you and four of them not so important. Put your resources accordingly. You don't have to spread them all evenly across the 10. Make appropriate, and I would say as much as you can, use of administrative data, because that's data you will continue to have. Weigh your cost and utility of what you're going to learn from your investment. So if you're going to invest in one-time data collections, that's terrific. But make sure that if you are investing a lot in that one-time data collection, that you're also getting a lot out of it. So you want your return on your investment to be equal to what you are investing. Okay, next slide. So the planning for the analysis and the reporting. I think this feeds back to what I was just saying. One of the things that we saw in some of the reviews we did is that the plans were not positioning the state for ongoing evaluation. So again, think about what you want to know this year, what you want to know next year, what you want to know, what are the most important things for you to know, and how can you use your PDG B-5 funds to position for ongoing program improvement? So build sustainability in, and how do you do that? By using administrative data, by building an early childhood integrated data system, so you have even better data, by thinking as you are doing each of the activities, thinking about, are there ways that we can get ongoing data in a way that will serve us in the future? The other thing is making the evaluation digestible. I've talked a little bit about this with some of the other slides. A limited set of questions at a high level, activities that you can prioritize and communicate. Again, design your evaluation and or revise your evaluation to be manageable, to be meaningful, prioritize. And again, I'm sounding like a broken record here, but maximize your use of administrative data. Okay.
I think before we go on, there was a question in the chat around some examples of sustainable data collection.
Sustainable data collections are basically administrative data that you're collecting anyway. Now, the thing is, one of the things, a lot of states don't have a lot of capacity to analyze their administrative data. But what you can do is use your PDG B-5 funds to basically kind of set up routines. So once something has been programmed, it can be push buttons. So if you do have a data analyst, or you can pay someone to do an analysis, a table, a graph, a set of tables, once they've done them for 2021, you can rerun them in 2022 and 2023. So it's making use of your data, and it's putting your structures in place so you can get your data next year and the year after too. The data will be there. It's getting your data analyzed that is key. So I know some of you have research and evaluation units, and you can certainly work with them too around setting the procedures in place so that you will get it next year and next year and next year. Does that help? And I just want to contrast that again with, I don't want to discourage folks from, say, doing interviews, because, you know, key informant interviews can be very, very valuable to you. Surveying parents, extremely important. Reaching out to your childcare providers. There are certainly times when you need to do a data collection, but this is just about weighing your investment. It's not about, you know, this is not don't do, It's just make sure if you do that you're going to get the return that you want out of it. And if you can use, if you can take your funds to set structures in place so your administrative data keeps producing for you, then you get some long-term benefits.
I think I might have cut someone off as I started to talk, and it looks like Jenny added some more questions to the chat about advice between balancing sustainability and qualitative data.
Yeah. Oh, that is such a good question. Qualitative data is so valuable, so important. You get so many good things with it, and it is so resource intensive, is the problem. I don't think there is a solution. I'd like to turn it over to all of you, if any of you are doing work with qualitative data, and kind of if you have figured out ways to set it up to be sustainable. I mean, I've never been able to do it. I love it. I do it. I do lots of qualitative data collections. But unless you have a line item for doing focus groups year after year, that is the other kind of solution, is to get it built into your a permanent stream of funding for you, either through your research and evaluation unit or some kind of set aside if you have any discretionary money in your state budgets, so that you have something that you can actually earmark for qualitative data collection. Because it doesn't come cheap is the problem. It's very valuable, but also very costly. Anybody want to speak to qualitative data? Are you doing any? And has anybody figured out how to do it on an ongoing basis?
This is Katie from Wisconsin. One of the things that I know we've been working to get set up is a advisory council that includes parental voice, lived experience voices within the community. So I suppose that is one way to try to make it continuous as opposed to the one-off focus groups or interviews.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Do we have anybody from Kansas on? Mandy, I'm thinking of I'm blanking on the name of it right now that they were using in Kansas.
Yeah, the R stories, Kansas, the story collections. I'm looking to see if Chris is here. We'll just really put him on the spot. I don't think Chris is here.
Yeah, we did
our tomorrows. Our tomorrows. Thanks, Deborah.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Yeah, and maybe we can find out more. We find out more information and write it up for you, maybe in the newsletter or something, a little to share it. But we learned in our PPE work group where there were a small group of states we met for a couple of months back in the spring. And we learned about something really interesting that Kansas was doing, and it's a way to collect qualitative data through a website that seems about as cost effective as I have ever seen for qualitative data collection. And so it's a really interesting concept of ways for families to tell their story, to share their lived experience. But Mandy, help me out, or anybody from, I see a couple names of people from the work group, anybody from the work group who can remember kind of what we learned about it. You kind of structure it, you know, we're considering changing, you know, this policy this way, or more specifically for families. Can families tell us about their experiences in finding off hours childcare? And then it's a way for families to go in and tell their stories. And you get a collection of experiences that way.
I think this.
Yeah, they also ask a really general question. Tell us about a time when you felt successful. Yeah. Tell us about a time when you had a particular challenge. And in that way, they collect data on all kinds of policies and how different systems impact families by just generally asking a family about wins and challenges.
So this is Judy. And so one of the things Kansas did also as part of that process, because it was part of their needs assessment, too, is that they coupled it with focus groups across the state. So they went and engaged with families on a personal level and utilized a very, very much a relationship-based approach in empowering these families they were meeting with on the ground with the survey questions also. So they had a little bit of a two-pronged approach in collecting their information from Our Tomorrows.
Hi, this is Pauline from Guam and our Technical Assistance Center. Just an example of sustainability on qualitative data. They took family stories of children with disabilities and used it as a social marketing piece. They took the family story, a little blurb or a statement from the family and put each family in a poster. And it was just very beautiful. And they're all different families and statements. And so these displays went to different places. This was of course pre-COVID. So just an example. And it would be displayed at shopping centers or banks. And it was a roaming display at the hospital. And so just getting it out there. And so that was just, I was trying to think what would be an example of that. So just wanted to share that.
Thanks, Pauline. I'm glad you mentioned that. I think I've actually seen that. And I think the other thing that speaks to is thinking outside the box for how to share findings. You know, certainly the 200-page evaluation report is pretty much inaccessible to just about everybody in terms of usability. But there are multiple ways to share your findings that don't involve the standard report or go beyond the standard report. And there's certainly a role for documenting everything you did in producing the technical report. But those short digests, briefs, visual presentations of what was learned can be really effective. So if you've got good communications people that you can work with in your state to really think differently about how you share. And again, you know, don't think about this as a grant with a beginning and an end. Think about it as an opportunity, as a catalyst. As you learn things, release things, put them out there. You don't have to wait to the end to write it all up. Share the findings, and the findings can be used to drive your next set of decisions and your next policies and your next actions. But it also helps people, when people know that what they've contributed has been used, you get a much better response from folks too. When you can point to, here is what we did with what families told us, that's a real incentive for people to encourage families to participate the next time that you're asking for people to participate in focus groups, interviews, or surveys. So put it out there. Put it out there in ways that are digestible and ways that people can easily get to. You know, don't bury it four layers deep on your website.
Kathy? Tracy had a comment from Washington. She says Washington has a state level early learning advisory council that includes a provider supports and parent advisory group that are legislatively funded. With PDG dollars, they were also able to create a structure with their regional early learning coalitions as direct connections to specific groups. And one of the things I wanted to ask you and Mandy and y'all's reviews of the PPEPs is Have you seen any states who are conducting program performance evaluation plans, not only at the state level, but maybe at the local level with their early learning councils or their local policy councils or county early childhood comprehensive systems?
Was that a question to me, Judy, or to the group?
Well, to Kathy, but I mean to you, Kathy, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Well, because I was going to turn around and ask
if you know of any. Yeah. And then yeah. If there's any states that have looked at doing program performance evaluations at the local level also, not just at the state level.
Would anyone like to speak to what kind of information you're collecting at the local level? Tanil has a comment here. Yeah.
This is Sarah. Sarah McGarra. I work for the Improved Group, a consultant and evaluation consulting firm, and we're working with the Minnesota PDG as the evaluation kind of consultant and support. And I know that Minnesota has set up a lot of kind of more localized or maybe call them more like activity-based evaluations in addition to the overarching state level evaluation. So for example, one of the ways in which they're using their funding is to provide what are called community solutions grants. In which the state funds a more of a local-led organizations and solutions that have a community-based advisory board that helps to do selection and distribution of funding at that more local level. And so then the evaluation efforts that are associated with that are also locally led. So what that has meant is that each of the grant recipients are responsible for developing their own self-identified evaluation kind of reports or feedback loops to the state. And so like the format of that can look completely based on what they would like. And the content of that is also really driven by the grantees and talking about what would they like to share back to the state about the funding and the work that they're doing.
Sarah, thank you for sharing that. That was really, that's very exciting. Yeah.
Stop sharing so we can all see each other a little better.
In North Carolina, we're preparing to kick off a project to do local data-informed strategic planning to align with their state's early childhood action plan. Let's see.
Yes, we're actually partnering with the Hunt Institute to implement a strategy to support local human service teams in developing their own strategic plans around early childhood systems building or system improvements. So we're working with our team to coordinate basically a training and a technical assistance pilot. Will help our local human services teams form teams to look at either current strategic planning processes or any new strategic planning that they are preparing to take on to make sure they understand how to access and use the data that is available and incorporate that into designing strategic plans for their counties. And we would like to make sure that these plans align with other state level strategic plans like the Early Childhood Action Plan, the State Child Abuse Prevention Plans, and many others that are currently going on at the state level. But we see it's more of a training and technical assistance, building their local capacity to access and use data meaningfully.
Thanks, Tanil. I think the issue of building local capacity around data collection and use, I think, has tremendous potential within early childhood. So I encourage all of you to dip your toes in that water in some way. And PDG B-5 is a really great opportunity to do that. Any other questions or comments? We have another poll question for you before we go. I do want to say, as part of the wrap up too, if anything we said kind of got your thinking going, if there's just a little thing you need, you can request TA from the PDG B5 Center for little things. They don't have to be gigantic. Please reach out to us for big things, for little things, for medium-sized things. But we just want to encourage you, if you need help with any of the things we covered related to the PPEP or anything else, you know, please reach out to us. So last question here and this is not your requesting TA. This is helping us get a sense of what are the areas in which we should be doing more work. So just help us think about kind of where states need the most direction right now to help us give us a little direction in our work. But then you can request it too.
Yeah, while folks are answering, I went ahead and put the wrap-up slide up. Again, if you have any questions, connect with your TA specialist, connect directly with us. You can use the PDG B5 TA email address. There's lots of project officers here, so you can always ask them for a connection. Looks like the participation rate's slowing down a little. Greta, you can go ahead and share. Can you all see? Looks like the biggest response was alignment across components of the PPEP.
Yeah, alignment issues, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Mandy, one of the questions that Meredith just from New Hampshire put up, which I think may be a common question across most of the grantees too, is where does APPR, PPR fit in this whole scope of designing, implementing, enhancing, drafting strategic plans in alignment with your program performance evaluation plan?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Judy or Richard, do you have some thoughts?
I can jump in if Richard doesn't.
Go for it, Judy.
Okay, actually your annual program performance plan is based on that 1 year of your implementation of your grant, and it's to measure your progress along those grant lines. There's gonna be elements within your APPR that are common and equal to some of the data and evaluation elements that you're collecting in your PPEP.
And I'll just add to that just a little bit. So a couple of questions have come up similar to that. Like folks have been struggling with the APPR, for example, if you're doing work and the work isn't going to be completed right away, let's say you're revising your needs assessment or you're making revisions to your strategic plan or your PPEP, and you have to submit your annual program performance report. The idea here to reinforce what Judy just said, those APPRs are actually a point in time. You're giving a report on where you stand. And for example, this APPR that we've provided these 9 questions for, these draft questions that we're getting approval for, that really is intended to cover up till December 30 of 2021. So if you're doing, it's understood that you're always going to be doing more. Back to Kathy's point from the beginning, these are living documents, these are living processes. You are making adjustments with every week, with every month, with every day in some cases. And so the idea is you answer your questions It's not the be all and end all. You're answering questions based on a certain time frame that you're establishing or that we're establishing. And you're saying, you know, as of now, here is where we are. Here is what we've accomplished. Here is where our challenges are. Here is the progress we've made. And with the understanding, or you can even make the statement that in the next 6 months, we will be working on this and expect to see changes or adjustments to what we've just shared with you. So the idea is keep in mind that all of these documents are living documents. And they're all, whenever you talk about any of them or you report on any of them, you are doing so at a point in time. And we recognize that what you tell us today will probably be different 2 months from today in terms of what you've learned or what you're accomplishing or what you're being challenged with. And so keep that in, don't feel, I think folks are sometimes feeling, actually Meredith said it, feeling constrained to report on everything we're doing. And in the case that you said, Meredith, you said we feel constrained to report on or evaluate the whole system when PDG is one small piece. Well, the idea is that PDG is about collaboration, coordination, integration, system building. The idea is this is supposed to help you create tools and systems and processes that when this particular funding goes away, you have those pieces in place. So you may not, the report that you create now may not evaluate everything in your whole system right now, but it should help you create those types of evaluation questions that you're going to continue to ask as things go on, as new grants become available to you. What we're trying to help you do is create these processes and approaches and systems that will be good no matter where the funding is coming from and no matter what new development is occurring in your state. So I hope that helps.
Richard, I could add from an evaluation standpoint too. Remember the slide with the evaluation questions? So when you're reporting on progress, you have six activities or seven or 13 activities that you are trying to do right now related to collaboration and systems building with PDG B-5. The evaluation question for each of those activities is, did we do it? How well did we do it? The PPR question is, how far along are we in doing it? But that's the implementation issue of, you are reporting for both sides, for evaluation and for your reporting on how well you are implementing that. And going back to your logic model, remember, if you encounter issues with implementation, then the expectation is make adjustments, okay? But it's the same, it's exactly the same information. The question is, did we implement it? How well did we implement it? But that's only one of your evaluation questions. So it's a subset. It doesn't talk about what outcomes you achieved. You know, there's a whole lot of other questions it's not addressing. But your annual reporting does address the, did we do it and how well did we do it?
Thanks, Kathy. And there was a comment from Disa Patel earlier where she said Wisconsin is creating a performance management plan to call out what we're monitoring versus what we want to prioritize for evaluation. So again, there's different ways you can use these tools to help you separate the pieces that you want to look at. How are you going to manage work? How are you going to evaluate work? And what other pieces do you need to put into place for your state? So thank you. Any other comments? People can take themselves off of mute if you want to either comment, ask a question, tell us how you're doing, tell us more specifically what would be helpful for TA, anything you want to add before we wrap up. And thank you for finding time today to listen to this presentation and hopefully find some benefit from it. Any other comments and questions?
This is Liz Calvo from Guam, and I was just looking in the chat at some of the questions, and one person asked how for some strategies about sustainability, and I used to work with Pauline Camacho with our CARENU program, which is our early childhood mental health system. And one of the things that we did for sustainability is we took families to our legislators and we held a round table. And, you know, I don't know how feasible this is for the larger states, but, you know, Guam, we're a small community. And it was so impactful to have our little ones and the families there in front of our legislators' faces. We had white t-shirts, we had little kids do art on the t-shirts, we hung them up in the legislative hall. And so it just, again, really putting those family voices and someone mentioned the visuals, putting the visuals out there for our legislators to see. And, you know, we were successful because we do have local funding to support our early childhood services. It hasn't always, you know, panned out the way we want, even though the funding is there. You know, the things happen and funding also gets taken away, you know, at some points. And unfortunately today, we actually don't have our Carino program functioning right now, but, you know, it was, I think if you, you know, again, just really putting the families in the faces of people who are making those, you know, those long-term decisions for our children and families. So I just wanted to share that as an idea.
Thanks so much for sharing that, Liz. Jenny Mendoza earlier said, I've been thinking a lot about creative dissemination methods like videos and infographics. It'd be helpful if you all are able to gather up some of these ideas in a short summary with links if available. But I reason I read that is not so much because we would gather that together, but I wondered if other folks before we left, if other folks had any thoughts about creative dissemination methods or want to build off something that Liz just said, for example. Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, sure. This is Kristen from New York, and we have taken some of that qualitative data around race equity and put that into like a brief, you know, with infographics. And we also right now are taking some of the information around mental health and the creative use of the ARPA funds by our early care and learning providers in our communities who are choosing to use some of those funds on mental health services and supports for their team. You know, obviously that will bleed over into their work with families and children. And so we thought it would be cool to put that all together in an infographic as well. And so we are just starting that process tomorrow. And from where we sit, it's actually a pretty great use of funds because it only is going to cost us $580 with this graphic designer that we're working with, that we can easily, you know, it's just a bite-sized way of doing it. And so I think it's really helpful for the policy piece. And then we're also going to do another infographic for the providers themselves, you know, saying kudos to you and be able to put that on our website and shout out on social media.
So Kristen, just to follow up with that. So is most of the dissemination then through website and social media? Is that the way you
Yeah, we'll do our council website and then we'll do social media. We have Facebook and we have Instagram and we have Twitter, so we'll do it that way as well. And then I always do like an e-blast to all of our partners, so I do that as well. So we get them from all different angles.
All right, thank you. Anybody else? Comments, examples that you'd like to share?
This is Katie from Wisconsin. One of the things that we've been trying to do is be really thoughtful beforehand in a lot of our research and evaluation projects that we're doing and thinking about our communication plan. Who needs to make sure that they're really invested in this and have all the details? Who just needs to be informed? Should this be an infographic? Should this be going out in through different listservs and newsletters? Should this be going out on Facebook? So we've been trying to be really thoughtful ahead of time so we're all set up to go as soon as the research product is done.
Thanks, Kate. Is it Katie or Kathy?
It's Katie, but it's okay.
Okay, Katie, thank you. Tennille, you just put something in the chat. Why don't you speak to us? If you don't mind.
Sure. Yeah. So in North Carolina, we're partnering with the North Carolina Partnership for Children and Duke University to Family Connects in rural areas across the state. Three major regions, two which are in like the mountain, the mountain Piedmont region, and then one which is in the southeastern part of the state. And they actually just recently developed a plan to develop three videos highlighting Family Connects, the planning phase and the launch within those three regions, and then a fourth video just highlighting Family Connects across the state. So the intent is, will we use those videos to do some awareness and outreach with our partners and stakeholders about the Family Connects initiative, but they also hope to be able to use that to share initial successes of the project in progress to support sustainability. So when the North Carolina Partnership for Children and Duke University, and of course our team connect with other potential funders, we can have that as, you know, a really good resource to share.
Thanks a lot, Tennille. So you guys know I like to do this kind of three-time ask if there's any more questions. So I'm going to ask three times and give you a chance to comment again. If you have something to say, please share it. We love to hear your thoughts and ideas in progress. So are there any more comments or questions?
One question, Liz from Guam. Is there going to be a work group, an ongoing monthly work group for the PPEP?
Mandy, I think that's a question to you.
Yeah, there is not a PPEP work group planned for 2022.
But Liz,
but you can ask for help and we'll give you the support you need.
And if it turns out that there are enough people interested in something, we'll put something together, even if, you know, if it's through the feds, through the FPOs or the TA provider or something, we'll put something together if there's such a desire or need.
It could be very focused, like on innovative reporting methods.
great suggestion, Kathy. Thanks, Liz, for that question. So are there any other comments or questions? Are there any other comments or questions? Are there any other comments or questions? Okay, hearing none, I'd like to thank Judy and Kathy and Mandy and everybody else who pulled this together. Thank you all for participating, joining today, finding time in your schedule to listen. I hope you found information here that is challenges you or sparks ideas for you to move forward and continue to, as Kathy's already pointed out and Mandy's already pointed out, continue to send in questions, or if there's a TA need specific for yourself, please pursue that. And of course, as always, talk to your FPOs if they can be helpful to you. Judy, any other last comment you want to make?
No, just everyone go forth and do good things.
I love it. Thank you. Everybody, happy Thanksgiving, guys. Have a great rest of your month. Talk to you soon.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.